Great. Let us continue our worship this morning as the light comes in and the prelude starts.
Angels, we have heard our cry, O Lord.
As the Bailey family is coming forward to light our fourth candle, the love candle, I also want to lift up that tomorrow Hanukkah begins for our Jewish brothers and sisters, and they will be lighting their eight candles for their story of faith in this season. Do you have the thing? You got it? Okay. Just the dollar.
Because too many people are wandering in the wilderness, because too many people are sitting in the valley of the shadow of death, because too many of our conversations are laced with conflict and bitterness, we light candles.
Because people all over the world are suffering, and we're too often distracted to notice, we light candles.
One for hope, one for peace, one for joy, and one for love.
May the light from these candles overwhelm the world.
May the light from these candles illuminate the valley of the shadow of death.
And may the fire from these candles burn away whatever would prevent God's love from being born among us.
Friends, be not afraid, even now, God's love is overwhelming the world on earth as it already is in heaven.
Amen. Our opening hymn, Angels from the Realms of Glory, the New Century Hymnal, number 126, which is the black hymnal. Oh, sorry about that. We're going to sing our Advent hymn, When God is a Child, on page 165, and it's verses 1, 2, and 3, and 4.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm sorry I was in a rush to get to the opening hymn. I did not mean to skip over that. Please remain standing for the opening hymn now, Angels from the Realms of Glory, in the Black Hymnal 126. Those of us in the next generation are getting ready for the Christmas presentation, and we need a microphone. Oh, no, no, no. Don't you throw that. I am going to... Do you need this?
No, but then I have to go down there. Okay, stop. Are we ready? Today's skit is called Too Busy. It focuses on one of the minor characters in the Christmas story, the innkeeper. While the events of the first Christmas happen all around the innkeeper, she is caught up in her daily routine and doesn't stop to experience the wonder of God's love or to notice what's happening right outside her home.
The innkeeper rushed. She was in such a hurry. All she had time for was money and worry. In her little hotel, all the nooks and the crannies were crammed full of children and parents and grannies. She growled as she answered a knock on the door. She didn't have room left for anyone more. She peered at a man in the shadowy light and a woman so tired, alone in the night.
My wife, you can tell, is weary and worn, for you see that her baby's about to be born.
There's no room,
the busy innkeeper said, and she showed it was so by a shake of her head.
I'm sorry, I would like to help and be kind, but I simply have far too much else on my mind. Although I suppose in the barn you can stay. It's there on the back, well out of the way. It isn't exactly a first-class hotel. There are flies, dust, and dirt, and the animals smell. But take it or leave it, it's all that I've got.
And the man in the shadows sighed at the thought. But he went and made pillows of hay in the stable for Mary, his wife, as best as he was able. And the innkeeper went to her own cozy suite. And there she made sure she had plenty to eat. Then she went back to working as fast as she could and did all the things that she thought an innkeeper should.
And shepherds were looking a long day as well, when an angel appeared with a story to tell. She stood in their midst in a shimmering light, and their hearts started jumping and thumping with fright. The angel announced,
"I bring you good news that the Savior's been born, who is King of the Jews. You'll find him wrapped up in a manger of hay."
And the shepherds all turned to each other to say,
"Come on, let's search for this newborn king as best as we can."
And they left the fields in the night, and off they ran. Oh, how delighted they were when they saw the baby, their king, asleep on the straw. Their hearts were joyful and bubbled over with mirth, and the news started spreading all over the earth.
But the owner of the inn kept on working so hard, she missed what had happened in her own backyard.
In the sky in the east, a far distant land, hung a bright star put in place by his hand. Three wise men agreed, "It's to tell us the news that a Savior's been born, the King of the Jews." They stopped and they dropped all the work they were doing, for something of greater importance was brewing. They loaded themselves up with treasures and gold and supplies that their camels could hold.
Through hot, sandy deserts, they traveled each day. The star was a compass to show them the way. Their families wished them well and were left far behind.
For months, they continued on, one purpose in mind, an important and life-changing, wonderful thing, to worship the baby, their Savior and King. And the day came when they rounded the bend and brought them great joy to their journey's end. As they bowed to the child who was sent from above, they laid down their treasures and gave them their love.
So the wise men and shepherds felt peace. We are told they had found God's great gift, far more precious than gold. All of them acted pretty much the same. They pushed aside all that they could, and they came. And the innkeeper, well, she's a different story. She missed out on the peace, the joy, and the glory. She could have said,
"Come in and eat at my table, or you could take my bedroom, and I'll take the stable."
But it seems she was hurried and worried and miffed, and she never took time out to find God's great gift. That gift is Jesus, God's Son, our friend, who brings us a life that with him has no end. He's waiting to enter your mind and your heart, to stay there forever and never depart. He knocks at your door. He's knocking today. Will you tell him,
"Come in,"
or turn him away?
We have combined James Taylor's version of Go Tell It on the Mountain with some artwork and movie. It is told from a seeker's point of view.
Over the hills and everywhere, go tell it on the mountain that Jesus is born. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere, go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Shepherds were watching over their flocks by night, but out of the darkness shone a heavenly light. They feared and they trembled, high above the earth sang out an angel chorus telling of the Savior's birth. Go tell it on a mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Christ is more. Yes, I was a seeker, I sought him both night and day. I asked the Lord to help me, he showed me the way. Down in manger, the humble child was born. God set the salvation on that Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus is born. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. You gotta go
Is this on? Yes. Okay, thank you. I just wanted to say a couple thank yous to, of course, the kids. Yay. And I want to say that a couple others would have been here today if they were feeling well enough. I miss them too, and I hope they're doing better. And I want to thank the sound, audio, visual crew, especially Caleb Kelsey, who helped with the video, and Shelley and Roseanne for helping yesterday. Have a Merry Christmas.
Thank you much for Eileen's time and effort to bring together a Christmas play.
Happy Advent, and isn't that our biggest joy right there? I wanted to share with you our joys and concerns this morning. All right, thank you so much.
Thank you everyone for sharing joys and concerns. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for a time of prayer. Beginning first with some silence. Loving God, as we approach the day of Christ's birth, help us to open wide the doors of our hearts in preparation. Help us to sense the importance of what happened so long ago when Joseph and Mary listened to God's voice through the angels. May this meaning become full in us and in all of things that we do and seek at this time, and help us to be people whose love grows in the world. May this season be for us and for all those around us a season of healing, of hope, of love and joy. Help us to be mindful, God, of the ways in which our daily choices impact the rest of our sisters and brothers on this planet. Breathe in us the wisdom and the strength and the willingness to stand in solidarity with those working for freedom and justice and peace throughout the world. Help us to focus our efforts, unite our hearts and minds, and the task of building a world where countries learn to share resources, nations learn war no more, and communities learn nonviolent ways to live together. May our church be a sign of living in this peace, hope, joy, and love. We pray these things and all those that remain unspoken on our hearts and minds this morning, saying the prayer that Jesus taught in the language that is most comfortable to you. Our Creator, who is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our wrongs as we forgive those who have wronged us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The scripture will be taken from Matthew 1, 18 through 25, the birth of Jesus the Messiah. Now the birth of Jesus the Messiah took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be pregnant from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to divorce her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the virgin shall become pregnant and give birth to a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us." When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had given birth to a son, and he named him Jesus.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Can't get too much love on a given Sunday, can you? When I was picking music to do with this choir, and by the way, we've had three short rehearsals to put this together, so I'm so proud of them and thankful for them to come out and dedicate their time and effort to bringing you this music about love. Both of these next two pieces were chosen because of this Sunday of Advent. And the next one, we would like to invite you to join with us on. And if you'll look in your bulletin, at the top of the second page, you'll see a little darker strip there, and it says mantra. And a mantra is a piece of music, or it could be even a spoken mantra, but we're going to be singing it today, that is just repeated over and over and over. And we're going to start out with that. And then when you get it in your ear, after probably once or twice, just join in with us and let your heart sing it out. And Sue will be accompanying us on with a little bit of the Pachelbel Canon underneath of it. And then the choir will move on and do some other parts. But you just keep singing that mantra. All it is love, love, love. All we need is love.
Thank you.
So this next selection we're going to do for you, we are going to sing it in Latin. And I'll tell you why we chose to do it. It's called Ubi Caritas et Amor. And it goes back to the 8th century, and it was written by a monk at that time, and it was a chant. But now today, because of what this song means and how it's so appropriate for this Sunday, we will find this melody and words in the Western culture in hymn books. So the words are Ubi Caritas et Amor, but before Cam and I do the Latin with the English translation, just a little bit about what it's about, and I think you'll understand. It's about paying attention to God's presence in the journey of our lives, embracing all people regardless of their beliefs. It's about God's presence can be joy if we just let it. That God's presence brought us here today, the presence in each of us. God's presence is our love for one another. And we are doing this with a sincere heart. We are all called to love. So that's what this is. And in connecting with our past, we're going to sing it in Latin, but you'll find in your bulletin the translation, the English with the Latin with the translation. And Cam and I are going to do that right now so that you can hear it, and the choir will sing it. It's a beautiful flowing piece, and we enjoy it, and we hope that you do as well. So. Ubi caritas et amor.
Where there is charity and love.
Deus ibi est.
God is there.
Congregavit nos in unum Christi amor.
The love of Christ has gathered us together.
Exultemus et in ipso jucundamur.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Et ex corde diligamus nos sincero.
And from a sincere heart, let us love one another.
Thank you.
From music of the 8th century, I'm going to take you to today's music on Apple Music. How many of you listen to Apple Music as your source of music? Not too many of you, really. I thought more of you would listen to it. Well, Apple has just put out a new feature, so to speak, and Carlos showed it to us. And what it's called Apple Replay. And if you go in and get to your Apple Music and you push replay, it tells you how many hours of music you've listened to this year, what the most popular song was, and the most popular album. So I want to share with you the results of our family, because I think it's a very interesting and illuminating and probably not so surprising for having a teenager in the house. So Carlos listened to 85,000 minutes of music thus far this year. That is 1,411 hours, 58 days of music. The song he listened to most is called Slither, and I did not want to know any more about it since that word sounds like a snake to me. But interestingly enough, his favorite album was The Beatles. All You Need Is Love. Okay, and so Terry has listened to 2,300 minutes of music, which is just averages out to be 2 days. It's a big comparison to 58. Her favorite album is Linda Ronstadt. Okay, so I've listened to 1,700 minutes of music, which is just over 1 day of music, which is kind of sad, isn't it? But I'm not telling you how many hours of listening to books on tape I do, so balances out. But it was interesting that my number one song was Lift High the Cross and Proclaim the Love of God. Isn't that okay, yes, I'm a minister, but it's still surprising that I listen to that more than anything. But my favorite album was, of course, John Denver. So there's hope for me, right? Don't you think music has a way of transporting us somewhere in our memory? It touches all of us. It touches our soul. It makes us open up our hearts. It's a language all its own. Describes a story for us. Especially at Christmas time, you hear a particular Christmas carol and you're just transported back to your childhood, right? It just all of a sudden does that. And maybe even through Christmas, you play the same carol over and over again. Well, mine is Hark the Herald Angels. And it's kind of an interesting story. When I was in college, I had a very good friend with a beautiful voice, and we went to the chapel and sing Christmas carols. standing next to each other. And my favorite is Hark the Herald Angels Sing. So when we sang that, she was quite surprised that I didn't sing very well, and it sounded awful. So I thought I'd just sing a few verses for you so you can hear. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Okay, so now you know why I cannot join Peggy's choir. But my friend and I, for 40 years now, always call each other on Christmas Eve to sing that song together. It unites us. It's a song from our past. It takes us back, but it connects us. Music inspires us. And I think what's underneath, what's the division? What's it all about? It's all about love. Even if it's a sad song, even if it brings us to a vulnerable place, it is a song about love. Now, we heard Ubi Caritas, and we understand what that's about. This other song, Love is Love is Love, was written by Abby Benitez. And she's part of a justice choir, and it's community singing for social justice and the environment. And they're out of Westminster Presbyterian Church in Minneapolis. And so all their songs are available for anybody to use for free. And I love that song today. Love is love is love. And I think it's a great song to celebrate the Respect for Marriage Act that got passed this week. That law by the Senate, the House, and signed into law to protect same-sex marriage and interracial marriage. A law that had to be put on the books before the Supreme Court undid that law for people like myself, who is married and whose marriage was in jeopardy of that. To protect love, for love is love is love, to protect love. I thought about that. And I thought about Joseph. That's where our story starts. For the Christmas story this week, it starts with Joseph. We always think it starts with Mary. Yes, Mary was pregnant, but Joseph is betrothed to her. He's a fiancé. This is Joseph. And he comes to know that his fiancé is pregnant. Joseph has a choice. In Joseph's day, who he is as a Jew and who he has been raised to be in the lineage knows the text very well, knows Deuteronomy, knows that if a woman is pregnant before marriage, you need to divorce her. You need to let her go. And that leaves Mary possibly killed, stoned because of that. We know in other countries that still happens. Leaves her family would reject her, and she would live on the streets and whatever would happen. And so Joseph is thinking, if I do that, that's what's going to happen to Mary. And he loves Mary. But he says, that's what I have to do because that's what the law says. So he resolves to do that, but goes to sleep, and an angel comes to him and says, do not be afraid. For your fiance, for Mary is with child. And this child is Emmanuel, meaning God with us. And so he wakes and he thinks about love. And he remembers there's a text in Micah, the prophet Micah, that says, what does God require of you but to do justice, to love God, and to walk humbly? And so he knows that it is okay. Well, maybe not okay, but he chooses it. He chooses love. And interestingly enough, that's what he does, is he protects love as he walks with Mary to Bethlehem. Music, love. Love. love being born at Christmas. Do you feel that in the music? Do you know love? Something that connects us, something that brings us closer to one another, but also to God. And so this morning, I want to offer that to you. I want to offer you the song that is already in your hearts, the song that has been born in you. And that's the song of love. Don't we all want to be loved and to love others? Isn't that our deepest desire for our children, for our parents, for our friends, people that we meet, people that need love and protection of love, people with disabilities, the refugees coming to town, needing a home, needing to be protected, people in all parts of this world who don't have a voice, and who maybe the law says, you're not welcome, you're an alien, you're a foreigner. Think about this story and just how radical it is and how revolutionary it is that God comes close to us and that love is born. So to you, I say, fear not, for God is in you and waiting to be born. And you take that song and sing it. Sing it with you this season and always. Hark the herald, angels sing. Amen. In the interest of time, we're going to skip the middle hymn and go to our invitation to giving from Don. Oh, Lord.
As we prepare to pass the offering plate, both real and virtual, I call your attention again to the Advent candles and this week's theme, love. My favorite Christmas album is John Denver and the Muppets, A Christmas Together. And yes, that is the same album that contains Izzy's least favorite Christmas carol. One carol, Kermit's solo, The Christmas Wish, starts out, I don't know if you believe in Christmas, or if you have presents underneath the Christmas tree, but if you believe in love, that will be more than enough for you to come and celebrate with me. In my opinion, today's Advent candle actually illuminates the entire Advent season. How, I wonder, can you have hope, peace, or joy if you don't have love? Here at UCCPH, I experience an outpouring of love constantly. I see it in the way we greet each other on Sunday mornings. I see it in the passion that our ministry teams apply to their specific missions. I see it in the leadership that brought us safely through a pandemic, one that shut down larger churches with better endowments. And I see it in the generosity that is evident every time we reach out for your support and tap your bountiful gifts of time, talent, and treasure. The carol ends. And if we believe in love, that will be more than enough for peace to come throughout the coming year.
us and time and treasures you have bestowed upon us. Thank you for the gifts to this church, that we might be a light to all. Amen. Our closing hymn, an opportunity for you to sing from the heart, Angels We Have Heard on High, verses 1 through 3.
1 through 3.
Yeah, 1 through 3. Paulus, let me know, he has a mystery message.
By the way, Don did a great job of coming. That's also my favorite Christmas album, and I don't think I would have had the guts to get up here and do that. So congratulations, Don. That was a terrific rendition. I just wanted to say a couple of things. This is an idea that kind of started in the men's group with Gus Burkhardt, was the person who first brought this up, and it's become, it gradually expanded through the church to the men's group, to Sophia's, to bringing in kind of the entire congregation. And I just have a gift here for Pastor Olive. She has done such a wonderful job this year. Talk about love. She has loved this church for this whole year, and we want to return a little bit of that love to her. So thank all of you who contribute to this, and I know she appreciates it, and we appreciate you so much for everything that you've done for us. So Merry Christmas.
Yeah, I know. Wow, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. And I do indeed love you all. And I thank you so much for your love for me and for my family as well in this season of love. Let us hold and protect that love which we have been given, that gift of love that is born in this season and born in us every single day. Let us protect what we have and also carry it into the world carry it into the world. I bless you today with love and peace and joy and hope for each of you. In God's holy name, amen.
No, I bet it was the odd lady across the street.